The Career Zoo, so if you're just tuning in, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. But the gist is, we're going to learn about someone's career, we're going to play some games, we're going to have fun doing that. I'm Callie.
And I'm Sean.
And today we have Dariel with us.
Hi.
And Dariel, we're gonna learn about what you do and learn a little bit more about the game. We're playing Mario Kart this morning. So what characters did you guys pick? Well, you picked Luigi.
He's always Luigi. I don't know. I picked a cute one. That was pink.
That's what's important. I always pick a cute one too. All right. So we're gonna play some games. But Dariel, let's talk a little bit about what you do too.
Okay. And just so you know, I'm not very good at this game.
That's
I'm
pretty sure everybody says that. Except for that one guy. That one guy's like, oh yeah, I got this. So I can't remember what his name is, but he blew all of us away. But so you work at NPR.
Yes, so I work at IdeaStream, which is the NPR and PBS station. And what's really cool about that is that we are multi-platform. So we will have a story on the radio, we'll have it on TV. We have a TV show weeknights at 7:30 called Ideas. So it's like a news magazine type format. We only talk no more than 4 topics a night because we try to give each topic good time so we can get in-depth and really talk about it. So, and a lot of the stories that I do these days are 4 to 10 minutes long. So I like that because I can get really in-depth and tell people great stories.
That's awesome. And how did you come to be at NPR?
Well, that's an interesting story. I began a long time ago, I would say, in commercial television. I traveled the country and from job to job. I went to Michigan State University, did internships in Lansing, where Michigan State is. And had internships in Chicago, where I'm from. And then just right out of college, or while I was still in college, I got my first job at the NBC station there behind the scenes. And then from there, I worked to get on television. My first on television job was in small town USA, West Lafayette, Indiana, home of Purdue. And from there, I just kind of moved on. So I went from West Lafayette to Fort Wayne, Indiana, to Indianapolis, to Detroit, to Baltimore, to Oklahoma City, to Cleveland. So I worked at Channel 3 in Cleveland for a little bit, and then I stopped working for a couple of years, had my daughter, and then when I was trying to get back into TV, couldn't find anything here locally, so kind of expanded my search, and I got a job in Richmond, Virginia. I was one of the morning anchors. Found out that was a little too hard to be so far away from my family and my daughter came with, but my significant other had to stay here because of his job, and so we were going back and forth. It's a 7-hour drive, so it was kind of hard. And so I saw that there was a job opening at NPR and IdeaStream, and got that job. And I came back here, and so I've been there about 2.5 years.
That's great. And you're back with your significant other?
Back in the same town. Yeah. So that's really good, and it's good for the family unit and for my daughter. So, and another reason why I came back was it was getting to a point where my daughter, when I moved to Richmond, she just turned 2, and so got to the point where she needed to get into preschool, and it's kind of hard to have a child in preschool because they need to be at school every day, at least I believe so.
That's subjective.
Yeah, especially at that age. Yeah. But it was getting to the point where we wouldn't be able to have her go back and forth because she would spend a couple weeks in Richmond with me and then a couple weeks up here, but she was young enough that she could do that. So it just became a point where having two households was very difficult. Yeah. So I came back here for family, and that's where I am, and I'm happy because I do have the work-life balance the work-life balance that I think I need to be a good employee, but also be a good mom at the same time.
That's great. So, like, what would a typical day be like to allow that work-life balance?
So, because it's a news magazine, and we create our content, with commercial television. A lot of times it's reactive. You know, there might be a fire overnight or a murder or something might have happened, and so we're going to see what happened to that story in commercial. So sometimes, you know, when you're in commercial, you might get a call and say, hey, we need you to go over to the west side because there's an active fire right now. You need to get there right now. That could be 7 o'clock in the morning, so you're rushing to get there. That's commercial. So, but when it comes to public media, so we're creating our content. So let's just say, like, for example, on Thursday, we had Art Falco, the president and CEO of Playhouse Square, come on our show to talk about the new building that they're building right across the street from 17th and Euclid. You know, they own, which I didn't even realize, Playhouse Square owns more than 1 million square footage of property in Playhouse Square, and then another million outside of, in the downtown area. So, but this is the first time that they're building a new building from the ground up. It's going to be 34 stories, going to have 500 parking spaces, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, so we called him, you know, at the beginning of the week and said, hey, can you come on the show? So that's one segment. So by the time I get in, say a Thursday, the show's booked because we've already planned stuff. And of course, if there's something that's breaking and that someone can come on, then we will change things around because it's still news, and so so we do allow for that. So because of that, I know it's like a long answer, but because of that, I can get in between 9 and 9:30, depending upon like what's happening with my daughter, and then just start writing. So because I am a reporter producer, I do produce the television show 2 days a week, but then also report when there's a story available or that I want to do. So I'll get in about 9:30, start writing or start making phone calls or looking for story ideas. We have a 10:30 meeting that usually lasts a half an hour. And then just depending on what I'm doing, if I'm recording, then I could go out and do some interviews, or I could blog a story, or I could write a story, research stories. If I'm producing, then I'll continue writing. We have a 1:30 meeting to prepare for the 2:30 taping. Then we tape at 2:30, and then after the taping, I post the story, the show to the web, and then do some things for radio, and then I can be out the door if I'm really doing my time management by 4:30. Mm-hmm. So
with breaking news constantly happening, is it like does it ever get frustrating that you work like all week on a story and then it could get bumped for like a natural disaster or something like that?
So with public media, we kind of look at the bigger picture. So like for example, with the shooting in Parkland, it's not that we didn't necessarily cover that shooting or cover that story, but we look to say, what are the other news, you know, we know that if the news, other news organizations are going to cover like exactly what's happening.
Yeah.
You know, this is what's happening, this person got arrested, this is how many people died. But we look at the bigger picture. What's happening with gun control? How did this gentleman get this gun? What's happening? Look at what the students are doing. Let's talk about the bigger picture, about what the students are doing and what change they're having. So that's the focus we may have. We also have a radio show, Sound of Ideas on 90.3, which airs... which airs 9 o'clock Monday through Friday, and that's an hour long live show where people can call in, they can tweet, they can email us and ask questions, and so we'll have guests on and talk about that. So there are times when we'll dedicate the entire hour to one topic, but then on other days we will do like three different topics for 20 minutes. I mean, just imagine, I mean, that's not something that you get necessarily with commercial where you're talking about one topic in depth for 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. And so some people, when we were like, yeah, you're going to be talking about this for 20 minutes, they're like, oh, I don't know if I have enough information for 20 minutes. And so, but they do. I mean, especially if they are, this is what they do for a living. Mm-hmm. And so just using that shooting as an example, so that's where we go with the story, not necessarily what's happening, but how can this change or what needs to happen so that there isn't another school shooting. Yeah. And that's where we look to further the conversation.
And if something like a Parkland or something else happened and you already had content planned, can you repurpose for the following
week? So for your question, which I did not answer.
That's okay.
Because our stories aren't some of them aren't necessarily time sensitive, mm-hmm. that it can just get bumped to the next day. So there are a lot of times we can, especially if it's a taped piece, mm-hmm. we can just move it to the next day. Now, if it's something, you know, so that we need to change, then we'll just call the guests and say, hey, we've had some breaking news. Can you reschedule? And then we work with their schedule because, you know, we're asking a lot of someone. To say, hey, you know, can you break up your day? Come to our job.
Yeah.
No, we're not coming to you. You got to come to us at 2:15, mm. and we will have you out the door by 3 o'clock. I mean, you think that's, oh, it's only 45 minutes.
Yeah.
But, you know, they have drive time or, you know, whatever. So I think that we ask a lot of someone to come in the middle of a work day to do that. So a lot of times we work with their schedule. If they're like, oh, I can't come on a Tuesday, but I can come on a Wednesday. And that's why we sometimes have to schedule a couple days in advance so that they can clear their schedules. I mean, of course, there are some people, like there are a lot of council people, like city council, that will say, oh, I can, you know, I can come today. And or they'll rearrange their schedule, especially if it's important enough or of a topic. Then, yeah, so it's so I don't get upset because my story is going to air. So it doesn't get bumped. So it's fine. I would rather that it air when it needs to air than it get shortchanged.
Yeah.
And can you talk a little bit about your school backgrounds that, you know, helped you get where you are today?
So, you know, I went to Michigan State.
Right.
I got my BA in journalism. Did 4 years of that. I chose not to get a master's. I wanted to get my master's in real life experience. Because what I learned in journalism school, I really enjoyed going to Michigan State. I had this one class, which I think just really shaped me as a journalist. It was one night a week on a Wednesday, and it was with my professor was a working journalist. She was a reporter, and so it was from 6 to 9. But we always, like, half the semester we had field trips. So she took us to the hospital. She took us to the police station. She took us to city council. She took us to all these places. She's like, these are the stories that you're going to be working on as a reporter, and this is how it works. This is how government works. This is how a police station works. This is how a hospital works and what information you can and can't get. So so she just really helped us learn what we're going to be doing. So I realized, like, I don't need a master's degree and talking about what I would be doing on job. I need life experience. So so that's why I concentrated a lot on internships. I think I had 7 internships. Oops, while I was in school. And at that time, and I think it still happens now, I think some stations are changing their policy, but they were unpaid. So I was doing a lot of unpaid internships and working another job. There was one summer I was working at the NBC station in Chicago, but then I was also a bartender at Finnegan's in Evanston. So those were long days. I'd get home at like 2-3 in the morning and then turn right around to go downtown Chicago to be an intern. So I put in a lot of work that way, and I really enjoyed just having the life experience, because as a journalist, you need that, because there are times and there are different situations that you can talk about it all day long. This is what I would do if I was at a fire and something happened, or this is what I would do if a grieving mother came up to me and accused me of doing something else. But to live it and to be in those situations, to say this is how you would handle it, you have to be in it. And you're going to make mistakes, and that's just a part of journalism. And I'm not talking about like factual mistakes or get someone's name wrong. I mean, like how you handle a situation, and you're going to be affected because this is everyday life. These are people's lives, and so you're going to be affected by what you're dealing with. I know there are a lot of times, like when I was covering homicides and talking to grieving mothers and relatives, I would get home and I would just be very upset because, you know, I would just take on their pain because it's just a sad situation. So I think I answered your question.
How would you say journalism's changing, like from when you started at school to now, and where's it going?
It's 24/7.
Yeah.
When I started, you know, I think we had a 6 and 11, maybe a noon, a morning show that was like half an hour. Now you have 2, 4, 5 hour morning shows. So the morning shows start at 4 o'clock these days. I remember when I was at Channel 3, that was a big deal. They moved it to 4:30. Started at 5, and I think now it starts at 4. So you have to think of that. Now there's noon shows, evening shows, so it's just 24/7. But not only that, it's social media. So stations want you to post pictures or whatever information you have to the social media so that people know, because that's where a lot of people get their news now. So it's not, in the beginning, it was more like, we want you to get it right before you do it. And now it's not saying that we're not getting it right, but it's okay, and the viewer or whoever's on social media realizes that you're going with the information you know at that time. So at that time, let's say, for example, you know, firefighters are saying they believe that three people might possibly be dead in this fire, for example. Mm. And then, you know, 30 minutes later, they just confirmed it's actually two, and they found one person, and that person's alive, and they're in the hospital. You know, so it's not that we got it wrong, but that was what the information was given to us at that time. Mm. And so they're okay, you know, it's okay to do that. And, you know, you have the Facebook Lives and the live posting. And so it's just for constant. You're always on, because, especially in breaking news situations, because that's where people want their information. And they're on Twitter, or they're on Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, wherever they are, getting information. And you want to give it to them, especially if it's going to affect them immediately, to know, you know, you need to leave, or you need to evacuate, or there's a shooter on the loose this place, you don't come here. So it just depends.
Yeah.
So
what advice would you have for, like, students that are going into Twitter and learning about us?
I would say know everything. I mean, I know you're like, what do you mean? Well, like, because, you know, it's at this stage in the game, you can't just say, oh, I want to be a banker. I just want to just read the news. No, there's no just reading the news. Oh, okay, am I being, something's happening. I'm like going down a, am I in water?
Oh yeah. Oh, it's pulling you back. That's okay.
Okay, sorry. You just can't say, I just want to be an anchor and just go in and read the news and have someone do my makeup and I'll just be pretty. But those days are over. That's not happening. So you need to kind of know everything. You need to know how to shoot, edit, report, produce, write, social media. Be savvy with social media, which I think, you know, everyone that's younger than me is, because they grew up that way. I see, it's interesting, like, people who have been in the business a long time, they're very resistant to social media, but that's where the news is, and that's where people want to get their news. And I'm like, I don't want to post all the time. I'm like, no, this is, the industry's changing. This is where you need to be. Or I don't want to shoot. I mean, in the beginning, when it was required or asked of me to shoot, it was very difficult, but that's because of the technology. Like, the camera was heavy, the tripod was heavy, but now, like, I don't mind shooting on a DSLR. I actually prefer it. I can, you know, because it's almost like taking pictures, video pictures, with a professional camera, and so I think it's really cool. Like, recently I shot and edited the story all by myself, which was fine, about the two female chefs that were semi-finalists to the James Beard Award. You know, I shot that all by myself and edited it all by myself, and totally enjoy it, because I love telling good stories.
Is that your favorite thing about the journalist telling stories? Or
good stories?
Good stories.
And when I say good, I don't mean, it doesn't have to be a good story or a heartwarming story, but just telling thoughtful stories. Like, I just recently, Idea Stream, in collaboration with two other NPR and PBS stations around the country, just took an in-depth look about the opioid crisis. It was called The Ripple Effect, or Opioid Crisis, The Ripple Effect. And so we just looked at all what's happening since the opioid crisis and the tragedy, and we partnered with a station in Oregon and a station in Buffalo. And the funny thing is, like, in Oregon, it's not as significant as it is here. So they're not having the same problems that we're having, or the same issues, or the death rate. And the story that I did, which I was 12. The story that I did was, I talked to the parents of Jennifer Ayers. She passed away in 2016 of a drug overdose. And her father and his fiance started the Emerald Jenny Foundation, which you would think organizations would already have, or government entities would have a place that people who are suffering from addiction can go to find where they can go get treatment. But they didn't. And this family took it upon themselves to create this website to have information at a fingertip so that people would know where to go, whether it's residential, female, if it's alcohol, if it's opioids, if it's in treatment, if it's just out of treatment. And it's very comprehensive, to the point where the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services now has a link on their website to the Emerald Jenny. So I talked to Bill Ayers at Depth and his fiance just about this, and just talked about their struggles and trying to get their daughter drug free, which, you know, they were unsuccessful, sadly, but got a chance to tell. I think that story was like 8 minutes long. That's unheard of in commercial. Mm-hmm. And I'm not knocking commercial, but I'm just saying what I get to do now is tell stories that matter, and as long as it takes. And because it, you know, in commercial, you know, you have to think half an hour. But the shows are half an hour, so 8 minutes, that's half the show.
Yeah.
They're like, we don't, and people, and you know, people when they go to commercial, they, you know, they're like, why is the story so long? But, you know, but at PBS, they look and they know it's going to be a longer formatted story, yes. So they're okay, and they're going to sit down and be like, okay, it's still going.
Yeah.
So.
Awesome. Well, this has been so much fun. Thank you so much for coming. And we really appreciate your time. Guys, if you're just tuning in, this has been The Career Zoo, and we're Career Gaming. We'll be back soon. If you didn't get a chance to ask any questions, please send them in, and we'll try to get Dariel to answer them.
Yeah.
Thank you so much,
Dariel. Thank you.
So nice to meet you.
Sorry, I didn't play the game well. But
oh, no.
So
I don't play the game well.